Reincarnation Part 2. This is a topic you are speaking about, something which cannot be understood through logic. And whatsoever I am speaking or I will speak is based on my vision. It is not going to help you in any way. What is important, you grow and reach to that level of understanding where you are able to envision this on your own, to live in the world. Questions and talks like these is not as important as you think. This is the reason that masters have not spoken much about reincarnation. Yet still they have spoken to explain certain aspects of it. It is in this light that I have decided to speak on reincarnation. When we look into what actually reincarnates, definitely body cannot reincarnate because it is matter, and we all know that with the process of cremation, all the components of which this humus of the body is formed, it dissolves. And each one of us know this. Whether you cremate or bury, it does not matter. Everything except the bones remain, and everything else dissolves into the earth. Then comes soul, the space. The space that we can call as God, that allows everything to exist. We can call or give it a name, God. That is unborn, unmanifest. It is never born, never dies. It is something like this. You have an empty space. You cannot live in that empty space. In order to live on that empty space, you have to create a structure so that space can be encompassed and be of use to you. For that purpose, the body occupies a certain space, or in technical terms you can say the soul enters the body. But when you are creating a structure on empty space, many things have to be put in place. So that which actually comes into existence again and again is the unfinished desires, unfinished works, and that assumes the form along with the space those memories come into you. There is a question in this light: is there any way by spiritual development that man can communicate with the departed or track his next birth? It is possible. but not with your level of consciousness. It is risky as well. And also there is another question. Can a person know about his past birth? This also is not advised. Suppose, for instance, there had been an incident by a certain circumstance and situation, the person remembers his or her past life. And suppose you are given the vision of the past life, one life, in which you had loved a person very dearly. Now, the same person is somebody else's wife. That person you are seeing is somebody else's wife. Now, your emotions will arise, but that person will not, no matter how much you try to remind her. So if you go and remind her and somehow or the other you convince her, you are disturbing her current life. And you are also disturbing your life. Suppose you are also married. And the person who was your wife or husband in the past life is also married, living their individual lives. If somehow you get to know about your past birth, it will create a chaos, disturb the two families. So existence has created a situation. The moment you are born, you come out. As long as you remain in the bodiless consciousness, the remembrance remains. But the moment you assume a new birth, it is wiped out. It is like a laptop which has so much of memory, so much of information. The moment you reprogram it, everything that is there is wiped out. And you come into the world with a clear and a clean screen. It is important. But you remember you have two tools with you, the subconscious and unconscious. With these two tools, sometimes the past will keep on coming. And masters will allow you to create certain meditation techniques if they realize that your unconscious and subconscious is creating disturbance in your process of growth. For you to clear that screen and continue the life with a new screen. For that purpose, without letting you know who you were associated with in the past lives, this or that. So for that very reason, communication with the departed one is not allowed in the scheme of existence. Certainly you can know the past birth if that be necessary in your process of growth. It's a simple computer device where many things are there. You are working on a project. And in order to work on the project, if that be necessary for you to go into the archives or your iCloud or any of those memories where certain information is restored, and if that be necessary, you can go into that information, retrieve it. If you have to open different screens. Your computer slows down. We can draw the parallel with the computer industry or computer technology when it comes to knowing certain things and we can understand on our own. If too much information about the past is floods into you, one can get very easily neurotic. As compared to that, tracking down the next birth is slightly easy and less problematic. But for that, you have to reach to that level that you live your life moment to moment with total awareness and you enter into death with total awareness. In that situation, you can choose your parents. This can be understood with an example. You have decided to visit a particular city. So before you reach that city, you have already made your arrangements for the place to stay. You look into if you have any contacts in that place. So that when you reach there in a strange or a new city, you are received there without any inconvenience. So either you book your hotel where you are going to stay, or if you have a contact, maybe you can stay there, or you will allow that person to come and pick you up from the airport and drop you there. So many possibilities exist. When an individual has lived his life with total awareness and he is now entering into death with total awareness, he can choose his parents. Now he has a certain assignments which he has to complete. So the person will look into where there is a possibility for growth. Suppose if you have to go to that particular city for a conference, you will look at the hotels which are closest to that. Remember, you have to attend to that conference. And to attend to the conference, you have to reach the place where the conference is taking place. If the distance is far away, it is inconvenient, so you will choose a hotel or the place of residence which is close by. So in the same way, the being or the soul or that space that you call chooses where the possibility exists for the continuation of the journey. So that is possible. I will take an example, and this was confirmed later on. Aurobindo in Savitri has a line: there is a power within that knows beyond our knowings. We are not aliens, nor as strangers join. We are bound to each other by a causeless force. My grandfather is Naqshbandi Sheikh, my mother's father, Naqshbandi Sheikh Brijmohanlal. So when his daughter was to be married, before that, my nani or grandmother and my mother, both of them dreamt that Sheikh brought a mango and he wanted to give it to his wife, but she said, "No, I don't want it anymore. Give it to your daughter." This was an incident when the pregnancy was transferred from my grandmother to mother. Something that I was to be born as the physical son of Sheikh Brijmohan Lal, but it was transferred. This is on the part of the arrangement that was made here. Now, when I am looking into the being, is looking into, just as you are surfing which hotel you should stay, where the facilities are good, the charges, the room charges is within your means, where all the facilities are. So my one purpose has been for lives, the transformation of human consciousness, how I can be of benefit, how can I assist God, as you may call, in the process of transformation, so that more and more people are transformed and attain to the oneness within and continue their journey. So in that case, there were certain aspects within the process of transformation needed to be explored more. So just as when you look into, I am giving these examples through that, because with these examples it becomes very easy for you to understand how things happen. You are surfing the various hotels, you look at the facilities, you look at the room service and all those things that are necessary for your stay. During that period when you are out of your hometown and you have gone to attend that conference, maybe for a week, maybe for a year, you have to stay there, or whatsoever be the time duration is not important. And when you are convinced completely, you book a place, an arrangement is made, and the moment you reach the hotel, transport picks you up and your room is fixed and everything, and you immediately start continuing your work, rather than when you enter into a strange city and you have to look for everything. Long time that was not possible, because the internet facilities, the online booking, the other arrangements, the mobile facilities were not available. Now with all this technology, right before you reach the city, you have already made the arrangements. Something like this happens only with those people. Now, this facility, is it available to an ordinary person? It is available to anyone who can use it. But you must be versatile to know the online booking. You must be familiar with that technology that is in necessary for this kind of work. If you are not, it is there, but it is of no use to you. And whenever somebody mentions to you about it, you may laugh. A person living in a remote tribal area will laugh at you. How can that be possible? This similar is the situation when you talk about, is it possible to track down the next birth? Awareness is the mechanism through which you can establish the connection with your new parents or the family where you would like to see that progress is possible, and it does happen. So in that case, it was possible for me to be in the company, to be born in the company or in the family of Sufi Naqshbandi Brijmohan Lal, so that the soul's journey continues, and whatsoever part was incomplete, that is finished. And the process of transformation of the human consciousness which I was to continue can continue. Now this was confirmed by many things, the from birth to events leading after the birth. Normally it happens the Sufis, they initiate the disciple. In my case there was no initiation. I was not initiated. Every night I used to sleep on the bed of Sufi Braj Mohanlal, and he instructed my mother that I should be removed from his bed around 3 o'clock, because that is the time when the masters or sheikhs go into deeper meditation sessions as part of their work. I was about 8 months of age. My mother forgot me to pick from the bed. I remained on his bed. It was a scheme of the masters, because he knew that his time to leave his work is coming to finish assignments that has been given to him. Soon he will be no more physically available. So before that he must make the arrangement, give all that is to be shared. It's just like you have many properties, you want to share it among your children. So before you leave, because afterwards it becomes difficult what you can do without any inconvenience, it will take a much longer time and many more problems will arise when after you the property is to be distributed among the children. So it was a part of his scheme. And from 3 o'clock until 8 or 9 in the morning I remain unconscious, as the word can be used. It is during that time, in a moment, all that was necessary was transferred, just as when you transfer something from your flash drive to your computer, nobody is seeing that, but it is transferred in no time. The data is transferred. If your computer is fast enough, it is transferred at a high speed. When you are downloading something, it depends on the speed of your laptop or this device. And this is measured in terms of computer terminology. In the same way, whatever information he was to transfer, he transferred it in an invisible manner. Nobody is seeing it. And afterwards he gave the instructions that I should be spending to my mother, that this child should be spending most of his time with his grandmother, because she was his custodian or the consort. After him, it is she who can take care. So there was no question of initiations or anything. Thereafter, at a particular age, I spent time with her. Then, when the time of education came, different story. But afterwards, once again, I was called by her because of certain circumstances and situations where I stayed for another 10 to 15 years. To complete the university education. It is during those times, one day I ask her, I am witness to everything that is happening, because in the same family, within the same environment, my uncle, the Sufi master, was living, then my grandmother. So the whole environment was of Sufi masters. What else do you need? What else I could have asked for or arranged for all these facilities? So I am the eldest, the young member. All the others have their families and married people, so I was the only one. Doing the work, preparing the personal things for this, my uncle, to all the other things, arranging for the meditation sessions, when someone is to be initiated, the preparation of the room, preparation of the facilities, informing the person what it is to be done and how that does this process take place. All this was under my supervision. So one day I asked in a complained manner, I said, Nani, nobody tells me anything to do. All I am doing it, arranging the meditation room. And in the evening during summer month, the meditation used to take place on the open terrace. So after day's heat, the floor is boiling. So you have to sprinkle water for it to cool, then spread the whatsoever form of mattress or things that were available and prepare it. From the time I wake up until I am ready to go to sleep, it was a schedule that it is spent in the company of these masters. What else could be the better way than this? What else could be the better way for me to have the company? So that is how the time was spent. So in the evening, that night, that day, she told me, you were complaining that nobody has told you anything and things like this. So she told me, your grandfather has given you everything, and when time comes, it will reveal. So this was a confirmation of the two aspects, the preparation in this city through your contact, where you are going to be staying, which is your future place to stay, and my arrangement from my city where I was staying. From there I made the arrangement through this contact as a communication between the person living in that city or in that country and I am living in another place. There was a communication and the arrangements were made that during my stay in this city I will be staying at this residence and these are the facilities and so. So something like this can be possible, just as in the modern technology you can do only if you are familiar with the IT technology. You know how to use the computer facilities. You can make that arrangement with just at no time. Nothing will be needed there. Within a moment or a few seconds, you can make the arrangements. But if you do not know, then it is difficult. In the same way, if you are aware and you are entering into death with total awareness, these arrangements can be made. It is here erroneous to say that you are making the arrangements. If you are sincere in your efforts, it is the existence that makes all the arrangements and gives you an impression, gives you the memory that you know as if you are making the arrangements. It is erroneous to say that I made the arrangement. On my behalf, the existence made the arrangement and gave me the paper. Yes, this is your arrangement and you have made this. It is somewhat complicated and yet still very easy to understand. Now, I am going into a part of the something when the soul leaves the body, what happens? This is an aspect of the dimensions beyond the moon. When soul leaves the body, it is bodiless. The space has become without the house, without the structure. Body is the structure, wherein that space remains encompassed. In that bodiless state, two things comes to you, to the mind. Does soul remain stationary or it can move about? And how does it recognize other souls? In that state, is there any possibility of a dialogue between souls? Many kind of questions. Sometimes these questions are genuine. Sometimes it comes out of imagination. So you have to respond to these accordingly. In this connection, a few things needed to be understood. Firstly, neither is there any stationary condition nor any movement in that state. There is neither any stationary condition nor any movement in that state. That is why it becomes even more difficult to understand. It is easy for us to understand that if there is no movement, it must be a state of rest or vice versa. In our thinking, these are only two possibilities for everything. We think that in the absence of one, the other must prevail. If it is not stationary, then it must be moving. Either I am talking or I am silent. But you do not understand, do not know there can be another possibility when two things happen simultaneously. We are also under the impression that these two states are opposite to one another. So firstly, you should understand that movement and non-movement are not opposite to one another. Instead, different aspects of the same thing. When movement is such that we are not able to see or grasp it, we call it non-movement. Movement is likewise a state of non-movement which we are able to comprehend. If something moves at a great speed, you will find it is stationary. You have a fan running in front of you. It has blades. When the fan is moving at a tremendous speed, the blades of the fan become invisible. The fan is moving at a speed. You will not be able to see the blades at all at that speed. You will not be able even to tell how many blades the fan has. Because the empty space between the three blades become filled before we can see it. A fan can move so quickly that you cannot put anything through that space between the blades. Things can be moved in such a way that even if you touch them with your hand, you will feel that they are not moving. That is why science says that all things appear to be stationary to us are also moving. The wall in front of you, which seems to be stationary, is moving at such a tremendous speed. That's why it is stationary. And that is the reason that it decays. If there is no movement from the very beginning, It is never born, never dies, so there is no possibility of its destruction. This is what happens to the soul because it is never born, never dies. It is as it is. There is no movement in it. It is neither stationary nor it has a movement. But the wall has a movement at such a tremendous speed that you cannot see it is moving. And to you it appears to be stationary. Just as it happens because the fan is moving at such a speed that you cannot know how many blades are there and you cannot see even the gap, the space, the empty space between the two blades. Therefore, movement and non-movement are not two things. They are different states of the same thing, differently, only in degrees. In the realm, when the body is no more, you are in a state of bodiless consciousness. Both these conditions will not be there. Because where there is no body, then there is neither time nor space. From what we have known so far, it is not possible for us to conceive of a realm beyond time and space. We have not known anything which is beyond time and space. What then shall we call that condition? We do not even have any word to express a condition where there is no time and space. We live in a realm of time and space, but that which is beyond time and space we cannot understand, and there is no word that we can use to express that. When during a religious experience messages of such a state were received for the first time, difficulties arose regarding how to describe it. What is the name of that state? An embarrassment similar to this is also experienced by science when it has difficulty in naming a new discovered phenomenon, which when something happens which is different from and beyond all our pertinent knowledge, our known knowledge. This is very difficult. For example, certain years, some time before, when electron was for the first time discovered, the question arose whether to call it a particle or a wave. Whether the movement of electron is stationary or wave-like. Does it behave like matter or waves? We cannot call it a particle because matter is always static. Nor we can call it a wave because a wave is always moving and is weightless. The electron is both a wave and a matter simultaneously. Then difficulty arises. Because it is our understanding as a thing can only be one of the two, but not both simultaneously. But electron is both a particle as well as wave. Sometimes we comprehend it as a particle, other times like a wave. There is no word in any language of the world to express this phenomenon where something acts like a wave as well as a particle. A very delicate situation. So when this question was asked to Albert Einstein, scientists who observed this, it seems to them inconceivable. It became a mystery. When people ask Albert Einstein why he was describing the electron as both a particle and a wave, they felt that his thinking was becoming illogical and mystical. Albert Einstein's reply was, then whether we should believe it, believe the fact or logic. The truth is, electron is acting simultaneously as a matter and a wave, as a particle as well as a wave. This is truth. And the logic says it cannot be two simultaneously. It has to act as a particle or as a wave at one time. This is how the truth is. And that is the reason it can not be comprehended in words. It is mystical. So if you want to explain, put it into the words, the difficulty arises. Albert Einstein in reply said, whether he should believe the fact or logic. The fact is that electron is both at the same time, but logic tells us a thing can only be one at a time. A man is either standing or walking. Logic tells us that he can be one thing at a time. He cannot be both standing and walking simultaneously. This is logic. Therefore, logic will not agree. But the experience of electron required that scientists should put aside logic and hold fast to the facts. The electron is an example. Electron, it is a part of atom. And it is not a mere coincidence that the Hindi word for soul is known as atma. Here the word, the letter, the sound is softer as compared to atomic. Atomic and atmic. A lot of similarities are there. Even in the sound. The experience of religious ones tells us that during the interval between leaving of one body and taking another, the bodiless soul is neither stationary nor in a movement. It is beyond our understanding. That is why some religions say bodiless soul is stationary and others say it is in movement. But it is only due to the difficulty of explaining. Because the boundaries of space and time within which the movement or the non-movement takes place is observed, do not exist during that interval. There is no time, there is no space, and time is measured in a different units than your units. That's why Hindus say that the night of Brahma is of so many years, inconceivable. So it is a way of saying that the time and the space does not exist. But for both movement and non-movement, a body is necessary. Without the body, there can neither be movement nor non-movement. A body is the only medium through which the two conditions can exist. For example, you see my hand. I can either move it or keep it steady. Someone may ask, when I do not have this physical hand, whether or not my soul will be moving. I can move my hand, raise it, bring it down. Because the physical hand is there. But if hand is not there, what is the position of my hand? Can I raise it or can I, is it in a movement or is it stationary? The question itself becomes meaningless because without this hand, the soul can neither move nor remain stationary. So I decided to raise my hand. The consciousness made me to take a decision to raise the hand, and I raised the hand, and I now bring it down and keep it stationary. Without this physical body in existence, whether movement or non-movement, both are not possible. So both are the function of the body. Beyond the body, the word movement and non-movement is meaningless. Then another question arises. This is applicable to all dualities. Take for example the condition of speaking and non-speaking. Without the body, it is neither possible to speak nor to remain silent. Ordinarily, we cannot understand that it is not possible to speak without the body. But it is difficult to understand that it is not possible to be silent without the body. Through the medium which enables us to speak, one can express silence as well. Silence is something where the words are not coming. You are speaking in front of the microphone. All of a sudden, microphone gets defective. You are continuing to speak, but your sound is not reaching. It appears as if you are not speaking. Silence is not only a state of non-speaking, but that of speaking as well. For example, a man is blind. One may feel that perhaps he is only able to see darkness. Immediately it comes logically to our mind. This is illusion. Even to see darkness, eyes are necessary. How can you comprehend darkness? How can you comprehend eyes? The absence of light is darkness, and the absence of darkness is light, but both are a function of seeing. Without eyes, it is not possible to see light or to see darkness.